So is this the only bio we have?
As some of you know, this panel has evolved out of the wonderful relationship between our class and the Dickey Center, and we're very grateful for that connection. The panelists are sitting in order, in the same order that you have your program. So I'm not going to introduce each one and give you their backgrounds. You have it, hopefully you have it on the sheet in front of you. I stole a quote from Gordon York via Kierkegaard. We live life looking forward, and we understand life looking backwards. And what I'm hoping we'll be able to do today is look backward to our years in labor shoes and the topics we covered then, to consider the present and then to look forward to the future and perhaps identify what the future issues of great issues are. Dan Benjamin will talk about great issues today. So we'll start. Gordon will talk about the world we lived in 1957. Larry will talk about the great issues of 1957. Chris will talk about his experience with one of the great issues in 1957. Dan Benjamin, the director of the Dickey Center, will talk about how he sees great issues today. And Jay will listen to all these people and try to give an overview of the evolution of great issues over 60 years. Gordon York.
Let me start with the present and thank Bruce and Tom Macy for putting together a great program here for all of us alums. A couple of memories. Remember sitting in the back row back there when this was the classroom for Zoology 3. And Roy Forster and John Copenhaver and Ballard lectured to us. Any of you in that class in 1953? A lot of you. Great class. And the other memory I have is being on the stage with Jay Green. We were in Henry the Fourth.
Part one.
You know, I don't like a mic between myself and the audience, so I'll try to project.
You want to hear? We're all deaf.
Overcome by technology.
Would you rather stand here
for
it?
I can hold it in
your
hand. Okay, is that all right? Sure. In Henry IV, Jay was Poyntz and I was Prince John, and Poyntz was the advisor to the king, kind of the same role that Sean Spencer and Bannon play today. So maybe he will play that role today. Looking back, I want to make my comments in two areas. First of all, the factors that affected all of us as we were growing up, going through Dartmouth, entering the labor force. And let me preface by saying, demographically, militarily, and economically, we were the luckiest generation. Brokaw talked about the greatest generation which fought the war and saved the world. People recognize the 60s generation which tried to change the world. And we were referred to as the silent generation that didn't make much of a fuss. But most of us were born in 1935. 1935 was the lowest birth rate ever experienced by the U.S. And it meant that when we came to apply to Dartmouth, 18 years later, there wasn't much competition. That was alluded to this morning by one of the alums. We had four children. The first two tried to get into Dartmouth. The first one succeeded. The second one didn't, and we didn't try after that. And now there are eight grandchildren, and we hope none of them will get in, because their parents have all been economically successful, and each had two children, and if they each put two children through Dartmouth, it would cost them $500,000. Sobering. But that's one of the changes. When we went to Dartmouth, minimum wage was 75 cents an hour.
First two that just came.
Tuition was $600. You could earn tuition in 800 hours a year.
Can I get them to
today it would take eight times that many hours during your tuition,
move over
not that any of the
front
current
front
undergraduates are working their way through.
No, over there in the front.
Wait
the second thing that helped
speaks
us demographically just was that when we applied
over
to
these two
grad school or professional school,
you want to move up? They just
we were a small cohort,
and, down,
and it was either get in to
Harvard
Law
three
or
seats, okay,
Dartmouth Med,
so
or
Hoover's
and
Library, so
or
pictures
wherever
of them in the
we
stand
were going
heads
to,
aren't in it.
We not only had a small cohort to compete with, we had excluded half the labor force. Our counterparts at Wellesley in 1957 did a interview the year that they graduated, and only about a quarter of them expected to spend a majority of their lives in the full-time labor force. The other three quarters were not competitors to us for graduate school and employment. So we were demographically very fortunate. We were militarily fortunate. We escaped the Korean War by 3 years. We escaped the Vietnam War by less than 10 years. This was brought home to me forcefully the first Christmas I went home and saw one of my high school friends who had been in Korea on the Yalu for the coldest winter. He came back without his toes. Didn't get that cold in Dartmouth. 10 years later, when I was teaching at Columbia, I saw the agonies that the undergraduates were going through as they prepared to go to Vietnam. And so we were able to escape that. Most of us who went into ROTC or other forms of military were out before we got called up. I'll always remember a call in 1967. I was still in the Coast Guard Reserve, and a call went out saying, does anybody want to volunteer to take a PT boat on the Mekong? I declined. And stretching over our shared experience here has been the economy of our working years. As I have sketched out in much greater detail, I shouldn't say sketched out, if I have labored interminably on the period in my last book, the period from 1950, end of recuperation from the Second World War, until the year 2000 was one of the longest periods of sustained growth in GNP per capita in US history. Probably doesn't match China now, but over a 50-year period, it was a pretty good job. That made possible a stock market and a bond market from 1982 to 2000, which has never done as well, and our houses rose in value, so that if we retired in 2000, we retired with money in the bank for an affluent retirement. And that's something that's going to be much tougher to do for our sons and daughters and for our grandchildren. Moving over to the personal side of the issues at Hanover when we arrived in 1953. I'm not dating them exactly, but during our period here, the big issues in Washington were senatorial investigations. It was the Kefauver Committee looking at organized crime, and the McCarthy Committee looking at the subversion of our government. And during that period, I also remember that our scientists were saying that we might be entering a new ice age with global warming, because all during the 1950s, the temperature went down, particularly the night the pledges in our fraternity took off the front door when it was 40 below zero. What were the big issues? I know that Chris Wren is going to talk about some of these, but during our first year, 1953-54, the Supreme Court was deliberating on Brown v. Board of Education. And they decided in June of that year that they were going to reverse 60 years of segregation, reverse Plessy versus Ferguson, and integrate the public schools. And that meant that one of the defining issues for the next several decades for us was civil rights. I experienced this personally in 1955 when I went for our national fraternity to the convention, and I roomed with the president from the University of Texas fraternity chapter. And after we got to know each other, he said, I'd like to make a deal with you. I would like a gentleman's agreement that you will not take African Americans, and that's not what he called them, into your house in Dartmouth, and I hope you'll work with the other northern chapters to stop that happening, because that would be very bad for your southern brothers. And I said, no deal. It became operative 2 years later when an African American rushed our fraternity, and we pledged him, and the National organized a blackball of him, and some of the fraternity brothers that are here in the audience today went and talked our own alumni into reversing the blackball, and he got initiated and served in the community, went on to a distinguished career in medicine, was the head of either Walter Reed or Bethesda, I can't remember which, and got the Congressional Medal of Honor. So, well done, Dartmouth. The other civil right of our time concerned the rights of gays. We didn't have any in our class. Or at least that was what everybody thought. And in fact, I was not even aware of alternative sexual preferences in the 1950s. That became a new thing in the later generations. But I subsequently realized that three people I knew during my Dartmouth experience, one behind me, one in front of me, and one in our class, shortly after Dartmouth and during Dartmouth, for one of them committed suicide. And I can piece together in retrospect that the problem was they couldn't go out and face a world which didn't accept them. Time. Okay, as a personal end there, I want 30 seconds more. The defining moment, the defining memory of my senior year was Harvard weekend. On Harvard weekend, we had the Hungarian Revolution, we had the invasion of Suez, and our president said, we are not going to intervene. I wish that some current presidents would have the courage and the standing to make that kind of a policy judgment. Thank you.
Thank you, Gordon, for denigrating my degree at Dartmouth and Harvard Law School.
Denigrating.
There were two speakers, the great issues that in our year that I particularly remember. One was Thurgood Marshall, and the other was John Adams. Others will talk about civil rights, so I'll focus on John Adams. I spoke up here, I lectured up here on intelligence a few years ago, 10 years ago, and then the government department took me out to dinner, and someone asked me what professors that I most liked at Dartmouth. I mentioned John Adams and Arthur Wilson. As soon as I said John Adams, one of the professors said, oh, he was a cold warrior. I said, weren't we all Cold Warriors? And they looked at me with contempt. That was quite a change. But John Adams, it turned out, his name was changed. It was really Adamovich. How many of you took modern America, European history with John Adams? You remember, he was a spectacular lecturer. And it turned out he was Serbian background. And he used to say the Serbs were the greatest people in Europe because they could reduce the most complicated social and economic problems into a simple formula. 9 grams in the back of the neck. Well, he inculcated in me an interest in the Serbs and Yugoslavia, which led almost ineluctably some years later to my accepting an offer to go as ambassador to Yugoslavia, which was a wonderful experience. But I will talk briefly about something he spoke about, which was the Hungarian Revolution in 1956, in the fall of 56. As Gordon said, at the same time, you had the Israeli invasion of Egypt supported by the British and French. You all remember that?
Yes.
The British and French were using air power and paratroopers, and the Israelis were using armored forces to destroy Nasser, all three combined. Eisenhower intervened in that and stopped it. And it had enormous consequences. What happened as a result of that is the French switched a position vis-a-vis Israel. Israel at that time had Mystere jets, which was all French. And France changed its policy after that to be less attached to Israel. Eisenhower was trying to maintain a neutral position, which is why he pressured the British and French out and the Israelis out. The irony is that the French then switched to become much more neutral, even in some respects pro-Arab, and the United States has become, over the years, much more attached to Israel. I won't go into the normative explanation, but it's sort of interesting that it happened. With respect to the uprising in Hungary, which you remember in 56, that sort of gave the humiliation to John Foster Dulles, who had called for a rollback of communism in Eastern Europe. And then when the Hungarians revolted, we did nothing. And so there was a feeling of guilt and a sense of despair in the United States. However, it had enormous implications because that led to an argument which lasted all the way into the Reagan administration. Well, let me take a step back. Under Nixon and Kissinger, and then Ford, there was a dispute within the foreign policy establishment as to how rigorous we should be in encouraging, in Eastern Europe, rebellion against the Soviet Union. Some of us argued at that time, some of you may remember the Sonnenfeld Doctrine, which was a doctrine under Kissinger whereby we should allow the Soviet Union to control Eastern Europe because we didn't really want to take the responsibility of dealing with rebellion. And some people argued, and I was one of them, that during World War II, the similar issue was presented by Churchill with respect to rebellion in the occupied countries occupied by the Nazis. And Churchill took the position that people who rebelled against the Nazis should be encouraged even if they ended up getting killed. It was a desperate fight. And so there was an argument in foreign policy circles as to how aggressive we should be. I confess I was part of a group supporting Reagan, the view that we should do what we could to disestablish the Soviet Union, Soviet Empire through prudent means. But anyway, that all came about because of a sense of guilt and the implications of not supporting the Hungarians in 56. Finally, the last thing I would mention is Thurgood Marshall. I was struck by a newspaper report that I saw in my own Harvard Law School material as well as in the newspaper. Harvard Law School, for the first time, had a separate black graduation. I was absolutely horrified. And Thurgood Marshall would have been horrified by that. As he would have been I knew Thurgood Marshall, he would have been horrified at the actions of many universities which encouraged apartheid, encouraged separate black organizations, encouraged black separate spaces. Thurgood Marshall spoke to us about the desire for integration. He focused particularly on the schools, but what he wanted was integration and assimilation. He hated the notion of apartheid, and I hate it too. That's all.
Thank you. I was told I only had a limited amount of time, and I saw it happen to Gordon when he went over time.
I don't know where anybody got this. Did you have this trash funny?
Yeah, we would. We've been wondering ourselves.
I'm going to talk a bit about, first of all, I got to say, it's a treat to be with Dan here. He's an example where we put our money in our program to work with them. I think it's one of the best investments this class ever made. And I hope it can continue. Second, I want to say something about the wife. So my wife is here. She has put up with a lot of crap in the place. And I'm going to tell you a story very soon about how she got me out of jail. And for all of you who are here, thanks a lot for backing us up. I don't know if you deserved it, but that's good. I'm going to talk about civil rights, covering civil rights. And I got interested when I was at Dartmouth. And part of it was the whole notion of when Thurgood Marshall came to speak here. And he was terrific, and I remember that. And when I got out of the Army and I was paratroopers and I went to work for Look Magazine and began traveling, I had a chance to start covering a major story, which is civil rights. What happened was that I was called a Saturday or Sunday, and said, you got to get down to Memphis, Tennessee as much as possible. They're having a riot at Ole Miss. So I packed up and I flew down there, and I guess the photographer followed me, to see what was happening. And we got in there, and we got out of Memphis, and they said, if you're going south, you can't, we're renting no cars. No cars are going south. They're not allowed. And that's what they all said. What is this? What's happening? So I got a car. I remember, having been a graduate of Dartmouth, I said, screw that. I'm going to go ahead and do it. I started driving down there. I began seeing soldiers. And I just recently, a year or two, I got out of the paratroopers in Fort Bragg. And I went down and I began seeing soldiers going down. And I began seeing people from the 82nd Airborne. And going down this road, and there were roadblocks as you went. And they said, well, they burned some cars down there. So anyway, I cut the story short. I talked my way through all these roadblocks, because there's always a Captain Carter somewhere. And I said, Captain Carter has had my dentist done here, and I just went down the road. And he said, oh, Captain Carter, sure. So we got down there, and I got there, and it was a flame. This was a war, and here was a town that was burning. And they had the tear gas in the air, you could not smell, they had been shooting, and I couldn't believe it. It began to clear, and these MPs from the Asian Airborne had come in with riot shotguns. And I looked at this, and there was shrapnel, you could see it. And I said, this can't be the United States, this is what you have abroad. But as I got into that, it gave me the creeps. I said, how can we possibly have a war? This is no longer the Civil War. How can we have a war here? Well, that war continued, and that was a very hard place to work right there. I bought myself a University of Massachusetts, University of Mississippi sweatshirt, just to walk around, partly so the Army would grab me and wanted what I was doing. And I got to know some of the kids down there. I got adopted by the Sigma Phi house there. who was fun to have a Northern reporter, and they took me in, and they were the nicest guys, and they were the most racist people I ever heard. Every other word was an N-word. And the thing is, like, I could have said, you can't be talking that way. Oh, no, and it was just so, and the jokes, I could not believe the language that was coming out of there. So anyway, I finally got that anyway, I don't want to dwell on that. But the idea of you going to a place and you see your country burning, and I'd done 13 months in Korea in the army, and I thought, to see this happening here, I can't believe it. It must be a mistake. Well, I moved on to cover more of civil rights, and I'll tell you how we covered. There are other reporters that did that. When you traveled, you went down and rented a car. This is when you could finally rent a car in. You first thing you did was take out the overseas light, the overhead light. And then you figured out how you got a map, how you get into it. The thing you learned as a reporter, if you get into a place, you got to figure out how to get out. We had to do that. I had to, at one point, we were chased by night riders in there. We stood out as soldiers. And we got a 12-gauge shotgun. I had a 12-gauge shotgun disassembled. And at night, I assembled that up because you get on the road. And we knew people really wanted to kill us. This was a time when the Mississippi, Philadelphia, Mississippi, where the three civil rights workers disappeared. So this was how you travel. You took your, and you turn your car in every 3 days. And said it doesn't work, the gears, you know, this, it has, the brakes don't hold and everything. And they got so used to us, we just flipped those cars because you didn't want your license number as a reporter floating around. It got so hard to move that I actually moved to Louisville, Mississippi. I moved in with a black man. And they were very nice. And then I remember that when this shack, and how you could eat off the scrub clean the way they lived, and they had no money. But it was just moving. Now I'm going to jump ahead on the Selma March. We had the Selma March. That was quite a great thing to do. This is a picture if you want to see it. I mean, the Selma March. And this is a book about the reporting that came out of civil rights. And I remember doing this, we were walking from Selma to Montgomery. I like to walk, so I decided to walk, so I had a car. And the SNCC guys, these kids, they're kind of radical, really very sweet kids. I gave them, I'd say, take the car. I'd walk with the protesters, and it was good exercise. And I'd say, bring the car back, and don't leave it empty. So the photographer and I would walk with it. And every time they brought it back, it was just running on fumes. I said, don't do that again. But we went through this, and I remember being at one place we stayed near Haneville, Alabama. And they settled on, people were camping in the road, and there wasn't enough food, but people were sharing. And people were coming from Alaska and these strange places for this march. And I looked, and this guy said, that looks like, and there was a flatbed truck, and this guy was up there, and he was I said, that is Martin Luther King. So I said, Dr. King, can I join you? I said, Christian, for the American DC, oh, sure. And we just talked. And he was so tired, but he just to be that close, and it wasn't a speech. He was just saying what was on his mind, and why weren't the Christian churches out helping with this? And that really stayed with me, because when I was in South Africa, a Jewish there, Nelson Mandela came out of jail. It was just something to deal with. I remember this experience. One other thing I want to say is, two things, is that when I was there, we went down to Natchez, Alabama, Natchez, Mississippi. Jackie and I just got married to this lovely girl, sweet little girl from Scarsdale, New York. And I said, look, it's not as bad as it was. Let me take you down there. So she says, well, see, I'd love to see it. So we went down there. We were going to drive through Natchez overnight and then go on to New Orleans. Look magazine for all that. And I got there, and that night I found myself in jail. They grabbed me. I was going 27 miles an hour, 25 miles zone, and they had me already registered with the address of the civil rights workers to be put in jail. And I couldn't believe it. And where's Jacqueline? Yes. And you want to tell them about the black jacks, the cops practicing in the back? They threw me in a cell in the basement. It was just really grim. I didn't know. Yeah.
Yes, so they We can't hear you.
I'll say it.
It's all right.
So there was the desk.
Jacqueline, hold on. Hold on one minute.
I'll cut this short.
So.
Diane's turning on.
So.
Hold it close.
Okay.
Oh, yes, so we were in a parade, we were following in a car, brave civil rights workers.
Thank you, it was a Klan thing.
Yes, and there was a police car behind us, and we had seen him following us. We were the last, we were the only car, and he was right behind us. And then all of a sudden, he pulled out and stepped on the gas and went about 20 miles an hour faster for about 10 seconds, and then stopped and said, "Look, you were speeding." And then, so Chris was put in jail. And there was this little courthouse, or this little police station it was, with a big desk and a huge coat machine and two chairs. I was in one, and then this great grill, and Chris was behind that. And I sat there for quite a few hours, and the policemen would come with their black jacks.
Black jacks.
Yes, and practice them on the coke machine. Right in front of them, just people going like this, and people, and then finally, they let Chris out, about 5 o'clock. I mean,
well, it was about 8 o'clock, I think.
Well, it was before 9 o'clock. Yeah, yeah. It was very dusk, and we got out, and the car was right in front, and all the tires had been slashed. So we had to drive all through the town, east, slash tires, until we got out. Finally got to a gas station first, and then to a motel.
Well, actually, we drove all the way back to Jackson because it was so dangerous there. And so then I put her on the flight back, and I went down with a photographer who'd been sent in to Bogalusa, Louisiana, which was called Klan Town, USA, but we didn't know it. I drove in there, and we parked, and these thugs came over and said, "Where are y'all from?" And the photographer said, "New York." And they were on us. And they chased us. We went all around. We finally got through it. This time they were putting up roadblocks to Klan kits. And then we got on this highway. And they were right behind us driving. And the photographer had a nervous breakdown. He was sobbing. And we had a Coke bottle embedded in the windshield. And the windshield was cracked. And they were chasing us. And they were trying to push us off into the bayou. So we finally got as far. We were going about 80 miles an hour. And we finally got to Covington. I called in the state police and to report what happened. And they said, "Oh, you got to go back to, go back to report it in Natchez. That's not our concern." So we got there and I turned the car in New Orleans at the airport. And they said, "Well, how did you like it?" I said, "Well, I liked the car fine, but I don't think you're going to like it." I just put it on the tab and I took off. So I went back. Anyway, we went back there and worked later. But that was the kind of climate you had. And what you learned to do, if the high state police were there in a hotel, you checked in right next to them. Because your safest chance was to be right next to them. Because they could disappear you otherwise. So you wanted to be safe. And that's something I learned. Now, I'm going to stop and tell you one other story. Went to Hainesville, Alabama. And this was an area just short of there that we'd gone through in the march. And I went in to see there, and I got into the town. I'd heard they arrested a couple of civil rights workers. And this guy walks up to me, kind of a real redneck slob. He says, "My name is Tom Coleman, and I'm a highway engineer. And if you don't get out of town, I'm going to kill you." Hmm? Whenever somebody says they're going to kill you, I take them serious. Not about, if you say it, you don't worry about the bullet with your name on it, you worry about the bullet that says to whom it may concern. But in this case, I think, and the doctor said, "Oh, I said, "No, we're out of here." 2 weeks later, these kids, came out of jail, white civil rights workers, and they were shot down dead. One was killed, and the other was paralyzed. A kid named Jonathan Daniels, who became a saint for the Episcopal Church because he'd been killed there in his Episcopal seminarian, except that he did a stupid thing in walking into this thing. You don't do stupid things when you're in a tight situation. So anyway, I'll just stop, but that's the flavor. What I want to say, oh, one other thing is that I talked about the people who I thought were terrible there. The Richmond, the Attorney General of Alabama was terrific. And he, with his investigators, helped me to recreate what had happened. And they were, and they said, you know, we don't need these plan types. And I remember writing a piece, and I talked about all the officials in the town who were plan members, and I said, they're starting to sue them. And our lawyer said, well, let's go take it to court and just see if they are plan members, and they walked right away. So anyway, this was very good for training for going to wars. I carried, you know, maybe 10 wars. But that whole experience really told me that how dangerous it is to work as a reporter and you don't do nasty things. And that came out of the whole civil rights. And even now, seeing the country burning, when I see what we see in the picture with the book we have laid out, that really stems the chill up. That's fine. I'll wind up.
The Class of 57 Fund for the Great Issues has now raised, I believe, $527,000.
Wow.
And this is just an extraordinary amount. And I would add a huge leap forward in a very short period of time. And we're so grateful that we're going to have another reunion next year. it seems to have an enormous motivating power to it. So, but I really do want to thank Bruce and Tom and everyone else for completing with us. And everyone else who was involved in doing this, because it really does enable us to continue preparing students for an ever more complicated time in a way that I'd like to think that John Dickey would have approved of. So, and we'll talk a little bit about how we're trying to prepare them at the end, but I think I'm supposed to talk a bit about what the great issues are today. They keep changing on me, so I'm not sure I'll get them all right. Let me just say that if you're a student of international relations, it's a great time to be alive if you can preserve some detachment, because we are confronted with challenges from rising powers, and as many have observed, there's no greater challenge in the world today than managing the peaceful rise of China. We're dealing with falling powers, declining powers, and I think all of us who have paid attention over the last eight or nine months and share the outrage over Russian intervention in our election can now take the full measure of just how challenging it can be to deal with a power that is in decline and that is really unhappy with the prevailing global order. I think that the ramifications of this are still not being fully felt. And we can talk about that more a little bit in the question and answer. But you know, Russia's desire to reorder the global system is having profound effects and may be the death knell for the rules-based liberal order that I think made this the luckiest generation. And certainly, I would stretch that that period of time to my generation as well, and the one that has come after. So. Those are all big problems. The one that probably gets the most headlines is, of course, the challenge of dealing with non-state actors, and above all, with international terror. Terrorism is a very serious challenge. I would submit that our fixation on terrorism, and I've made good money for a number of years working on the issue, but that our fixation on terrorism has probably distracted us more than it should have from the challenges of rising and falling powers. And that is part of the reason that we're in the mess we're in. No one has written the article yet, but I think that from my own experience in the US government, we paid so much attention to terrorism that maybe we weren't thinking strategically about Russia as we should have, and we weren't devoting the bandwidth that we should have over the last decade and really thought hard about what the consequences were of a power that felt that it had been shorn of global standing and that was desperate to reestablish its position in the arena and also to undermine all those things that have really undergirded our power in international affairs. Not all bad news is bad in the same way, or equally bad, if I can adapt Tolstoy a little bit. But just to buttress my argument about terrorism, and also to underscore how well we've done against the terrorist threat in recent years, and I certainly would agree that it is a big, big problem in many other parts of the world, and certainly worse for our friends in Europe than it is for us. As a percentage of all homicides since the day after 9/11, terrorist deaths in the United States from jihadis amount to 1/200 of 1% of all homicides. And I think that's a noteworthy fact. And last year, which was the worst year that we've had since 9/11, 1/3 of 1% of all homicides in the country could be attributed to terrorism. That doesn't mean we shouldn't continue spending an awful lot of money on the problem and being vigilant, but it does mean that we need to think hard about the consequences of focusing so exclusively as we have. And I think that's, well, I hope that's something to think about. Just to add, I know everyone's interested in cyber terrorism, or in cyber affairs, cybersecurity. I would just say that for now, cybersecurity, while it's a fascinating area, remains actually a subcase of falling and rising powers. We do not yet have the case of a terrorist group that has really used cyber instruments to damage our security. There's a lot of criminality online, but the terrorists thus far have not mastered these capabilities. What are the other big issues out there? Well, I'm going to refer mostly to sort of our program at Dickey in this regard, because I think we've picked the big ones. There continues to be an enormous problem with climate change, which has the potential to be a profoundly transformative event in our lives and the lives of our children and grandchildren, and that could have such far-reaching consequences that I think that to ignore it or to suggest that the science isn't there is both cavalier and irresponsible. Development. We're a much more tightly knit globe than we were perhaps in 1957, and therefore issues of development are very important, and they're important not just for the well-being of people in other countries, but also for peace and security, because countries that are falling apart are countries that go to war to distract their people from the fact that things are falling apart, and they tend to have a high degree of volatility and violence. And by the way, climate change also is increasingly being cited as a major reason for conflict. There is the issue of global health. I think as we saw with the Ebola outbreak, the Ebola epidemic in Western Africa just a few years ago, in a globalized world, the potential of infectious disease to disrupt countries, disrupt economies, and cause panic, you know, it's hardly rivaled. I remember I was in Germany on a family visit, and my son's like most kids in hotels are watching the TV, and they said, "Daddy, are they ever going to stop watching that plane with that one victim who's just flown into Dallas?" The amount of attention we pay to that, I think, is vitally important. And it comes at a time when the international architecture for dealing with global health is severely strained, and I think quite worried about the future, because the United States has been the single largest donor to the international health system, and that can no longer be assured for the future. Similarly with development, you know, we've been the biggest development donor in aggregate, not as a percentage of our GDP, but in aggregate, and with the administration planning to cut back USAID's funding the low estimate is 30%, the high estimate 70%. This could have a profound effect on not just, you know, human suffering, but peace and stability around the world. At the end of the day, I will say that I think that the biggest threat that we face, and one that we as the Gibney Center have not yet gotten our arms around, is actually polarization at home. And in this, I'm agreeing with my friend Secretary Mattis, who, as some of you may know, is one of the first people I brought here to, for about 3 weeks in 2013. Polarization at home undercuts the United States' ability to lead in the world and to deal in a thoughtful and deliberate way with the problems that we face. And I think that there's nothing more dangerous that we face right now. It may not result in rioting in the streets, and there may not be bloodshed, but it is nonetheless, I would say, a dagger, to use an old melodramatic metaphor, it's a dagger pointed at the heart of the liberal order and the U.S. And the U.S. leadership. That's my rundown of big issues. I don't know how we're going to get a polarization, but it's something that we need to think about. And as we think about training students at Dartmouth for the future, I think, and training them to be leaders, and I hope, if the word isn't too discredited, elites of the future, we have to also figure out ways to have them think more broadly and figure out how they're going to connect with the many people in the country who are just not interested in these issues anymore and feel that they don't touch them. So let me just close by saying a few ways in which we are doing this. One way we're doing training people to care to view the world's problems as their own is that we begin with, we start the freshman year instead of senior year, as people did in 1957 when they took the Great Issues course. And we're trying to provide a full menu of activities from the day they walk in, when they're eligible for the Great Issues Scholars Program, which is now for first years, and in which they spend a year coming to events, not for credit, but to educate themselves about war and peace, about global health, about climate, about development, and all kinds of different things that fall under those headings. We have roughly 80 students a year participating in this, and when you consider how incredibly busy these students are, and that they'll come to, I see Casey's in the back, we've had students who are coming to 18, 20, 22 events a year. It's really a remarkable thing, and we're very fortunate to have fabulous staff at Dickey who are structuring these things. They can be, these events can be as simple as reading a book together, and as August is sitting down for a chat with Madeleine Albright, and we've had an awful lot of interesting people come through. One of the things that we do that the original Great Issues course did is that we focus a lot on bringing the people who really know and who are really the newsmakers here to meet students, and they'll meet not just with the Great Issues students, but also with our students in War and Peace, who are War and Peace fellows, with our Global Health fellows, with people studying development and the like. I'm happy to say that just in the last year or so, who did we have? Well, we had Deputy Secretary of State Tony Blinken, who just departed. We had Harold Cohn, been the legal advisor at the State Department. Michelle Flournoy, the Undersecretary of Defense for Policy. Dan Fried, former Assistant Secretary of State for Europe, and one of the architects of NATO enlargement, who was here to talk about Russia. And we also have many, many more people who are not who have not come out of the government. We have Richard Horton, the editor-in-chief of The Lancet, Britain's foremost medical journal, who was our keynote at a fabulous symposium on the road ahead in global health. We've had, the list of people we've had talking about climate change will keep us here for the rest of your time. So I won't go through all of that. But we do believe that it's important for the students to have contact with these people. And you know, there are many different ways of teaching leadership, but one of the sure ones is put people in contact with leaders. And I think we've had a lot of success with that. We have also focused a lot on the experiential, following on Phil Hanlon's emphasis. emphasis on that. So whether it's going over to the ice core labs to talk to the scholars at Enfield, a 10,000-year-old ice core, or doing actually a full-day simulation of the Civil War in Syria, which we did just a couple of months ago with two of the top game designers from the military. We really want the students to be active in what they're doing and not just listen to these people who are talking at them. I will stop there. But again, I want to just close on a note of gratitude, which is really important. I think that we all feel very, very fortunate to be benefiting from the fact that we're an institution whose alums love it so much. And that is really a great thing. It's great for the students to feel that, but it's also great for those of us who are trying to work and give the students the best possible experience. So thank you so much.
I was very grateful to Gordon for reminding us that in this room we took a Zoe course back in those dear dead days, because I was somewhat apprehensive, and I mentioned this to Joe Conley when I came over here, that it was in another room in Silsbee that I flunked physics. And I thought this might be the room, the black cloud. So, but thank you, Gordon. We've overcome that. Bruce asked me to talk about the evolution of great issues over the year. The issues themselves, this is great issues, lowercase. But I wanted to talk a little bit about the course we took, which, if you remember, every Monday night we met in 105 Dartmouth, and we were supposed to write, and we did, a journal and turn it into a faculty advisor and be graded on it. And that, I thought, was a terrific exercise. And I was so delighted to be told at the outset of that course that you could write on anything for your journal entry for that week. It was due on Friday, I believe, and then we went to the next GI session the following Monday. But you could use the talk as a takeoff. You could argue with the presenter of that talk. You could agree with him, him or her. Or you could just use it as a taking off point to write about whatever you wanted. I thought that was a wonderful experience. I reviewed the journal the other day, my journal, I still kept it. Love to see what I've written. And we had, as was mentioned, Thurgood Marshall, we had Barbara Ward, who was a major economist at the time. We had Hugh Gaitskill, who was a rising star in the Labour Party of England, later Prime Minister. We had Richard Everhart speak to us. First-class poet at that time and later. And we had a number of the Dartmouth faculty speak to us on a number of issues, including Professor Radway. I recall his talk. So we really had a wide-ranging course, and it was such a, I thought at the time, and I still do, and I think a number of us do, a marvelous course. Great Issues as a course for seniors started in 1947, so it was 10 years old when we took it. It was for seniors, and it went on for a few years thereafter, and then sort of dribbled away into the sands of the 1960s, and went out of business as a course for seniors or anybody else. And then was revived, as Dan mentioned, in the first, I believe, the first decade of this new century, with the GI scholars, the Great Issues scholars, and they are freshmen, and they apply and are selected, so it's a winnowing process, and as Dan mentioned, they are selected and told that this is going to be a hands-on experience, experiential learning is the phrase around campus these days. And I had an illustration of this yesterday afternoon. A number of us attended the talk on human origins over in Moore, given by Professors Dominique and De Silva. And here was a situation in which the students took this course during the fall term, and the fall term ended just before Thanksgiving. And then the students who took this course went on a trip to Africa that went from between Thanksgiving and Christmas, a three-week time period. And this is where they got to see right up close and personal the sites, the archaeological and paleontological sites that they had been studying about in this course, and handle the fossils and talk to the people who were doing all the fossil exploration. So that was, to me, a great illustration of experiential learning. Issues have obviously evolved over 60 years. We were very focused, again, looking at the journal. One of the big topics that went on for five or six talks were various aspects of the relationship between the United States and Western Europe. And I think we all remember there were constant articles in the 50s and the 60s and the 70s from Europeans wondering whether the United States could be trusted, that we might pull the plug on our engagement with the world and back out. Of course, we didn't, but this was great fodder for European questioning of America's motives and intentions. There was a course, Civil Rights, in our Great Issues course of 1957, and of course that became even closer, especially to folks like Chris, just a decade later. We were in the midst of the Cold War, remember that, and I don't think we can forget it. And so all the issues surrounding the Cold War, tensions with the Soviet Union, isn't that a remarkable phrase? How many of us speak of the Soviet Union today? But Russia's back in the forefront, right? So there were all the tensions with the Soviet Union, and there was detente with the Soviet Union, and then there was a question of whether detente was the proper policy to follow, with Hawks saying you can't trust them, and detente is a chimera, and we should abandon it. And then all of a sudden, the wall came down. What a great year 1989 was. And if you remember, in the spring of that year, there were rumblings in Eastern Europe, East Germany, and in the summertime, for whatever reason, the East German government decided that they would allow East Germans to take their vacation in Hungary. As a matter of fact, I believe they've been doing that for quite a while. The Hungarians decided, quite on their own, that they would open the border with Austria. And a number of East Germans thought to themselves, this is the summer we take a trip to Hungary. Because now we can nip over the border into Austria, we can work our way around to West Germany. And remember, West Germany was paying a bounty to anyone who came over, any German who came over. And there was not only a bounty, but there was employment. There was a lot of wonderful things that you were able to make it to the West. And so this went on throughout this year of 1989, and then in November, all of a sudden, the East German authorities decide that they are no longer going to prohibit egress from East Germany through the wall. And this was decided in the day's meeting, and the press officer for the East German government was sent out and made this announcement only there was no time stipulation. We are no longer going to prohibit egress through the wall. And a savvy reporter says, when is this effective? The fellow was totally puzzled, kind of looked around, and nobody could refer to it. He said, immediately. And that was it. And the gates were open. The guards no longer had their AK-47s at the ready, and people flooded across, and then the wall was gradually demolished. And that was one of the great events of our lifetime. And I think we should all remember it after all the years of the Cold War. And how naive we were thinking that now all the tensions were gone. There were no more tensions in the world, were there? The great opponent in the Cold War had collapsed. And Yeltsin was a drunk and a funny fellow, and we probably should help the former Soviet Union a little bit. Clinton tried to do that, but it was only a partial success. And we never saw Putin coming, did we? And there's this rascal that all of a sudden is being promoted as president of the new president of the new Russia and former KGB. And that was a little ominous, but that's where we are today. So the issues have morphed over the years. I don't believe we spoke a great deal at the time, late 50s, about environmental concerns. Remember, Rachel Carson had come out in 1953 with a book, Silent Spring, correct. And that was a very powerful book. It was powerful at the time. It's remained so. But that was really our contact with environmental issues. Because, as was pointed out earlier, the U.S. was growing at a fantastic rate, and we were all doing very well. I remember acutely the fall of 1956 when, as was referenced, we had Larry Silverman mentioned this, the simultaneous, the concatenation of the British, French, Israeli attack on Egypt and the Hungarian Revolution. And if I certainly remember very acutely, I'm sure you do, that John Foster Dulles, our Secretary of State in the early years of the Eisenhower administration, was talking about rolling back the Iron Curtain. And we knew that if the peoples in the thrall of the Soviet Union in Eastern Europe were ever to rise, we would spring to their aid and assist them in achieving freedom on their own. And then came the Hungarian Revolution, and partially spoiled by the British-French-Israeli attack on Egypt, that really deflected a lot of attention away from the Hungarian rising. But to our shame, I think, we failed to act on this boastful policy that we were going to roll back the Iron Curtain. I remember receiving a letter from a Danish friend of mine just as the Hungarian Revolution was occurring and saying how strongly she felt that she was no longer a Dane, she was a European. That's how it affected folks on the front line in Europe. Mm-hmm. So great issues have evolved, lowercase great issues have evolved over the years, and Dan rattled off an almost intimidating list of the things we're grappling with today. I may be a Pollyanna, probably am. I am not as troubled by the problems that are facing us, even the polarization that Dan mentioned, because I believe the United States is a much more resilient country. As fractured as we are, as polarized as we are today, as disputatious as we are with each other, and we are. Americans are a disputatious, unhappy, cantankerous people, and we always have been. Read some of the arguments of for and against the Constitution in 1787, 1788. We've been through a civil war that would have permanently separated any number of other countries had they undergone it, or certainly changed enormously the focus of the country. We went through a Great Depression in the 30s, and Gordon was mentioning how lucky we are, and he's quite right. We are the luckiest generation. But the Depression was an enormously trying time for America, with people really seriously questioning whether our form of government, as it was then being practiced, was the right way to go. And there were folks on the right who said, look at this fellow Mussolini, look at this fellow Hitler, they've got the problem solved. Those people are unified and they're getting the job done. Remember, in Italy, the trains all ran on time. And then there were the folks on the left who said, no, look, we've got to collectivize and get focused and look at what a great job Stalin was doing and really solving all those problems. And so there wasn't just tension. There were fights in the streets, not just in Europe, but in the United States, fights in the streets between the right and the left, between the fascists and the communists and almost everybody in between. So in my view, we've been here before, and the United States has risen above it and gone on to really great things. But as I say, that may be a Pollyanna attitude. Anyway, that's the conclusion of my remarks. And, I turn over to Taylor. Thank you.
Thank you all. I failed to say when I introduced this that you should have postcards, which are one of the ways in which we communicate back and forth with the great issue scholars. These are the students that our class supports, and they send postcards to us talking about how they are using their experience and learning from it. So that I hope you read that. And also the Crossroads, which dealt with another meeting that we had with the Dickey Center. Thank you all. I'd like to open it up to discussion, comments, thoughts, criticisms, concerns, and also give the panel a chance to talk to one another. Bob?
Well,
hold on a minute. Al's going to come.
Thank you. Unlike Jerry, I'm from the Bloom and Doom School. And I think Dan has put his finger on the polarization crisis. It's much worse than we know. I think we deliberately miseducate most of the people in this country, and that this has been exacerbated by the way the press is falling apart. I think they did a good job. And I think back, and while we did have a great time at Great Issues, we also missed a lot of the great issues, as Jay points out. We missed the environment. I'm incredulous to listen to six white men up there, and there has not been a single mention of, really, other than Gordon's reference to Wellesley, of women. At any rate, comment.
Well, they clearly didn't think it was a great issue.
Not a great issue.
Is that supposed to be an issue?
Not a great
maybe not your life. I would love to hear from both the men and the women, because that we certainly missed the women's movement, which started just a few years after our graduation. Now maybe because we were an all-male college, I don't know, but I'd love to hear your thoughts, because it also brings up for me what issues might Dan be missing now? What's the next thing around the corner?
Wendy, you have something to say?
Well.
Should be up here. Diane will turn it over.
You were talking, I forget who was saying, I think you were saying that you visited a southern fraternity. It was you who was saying that. And we were actually astonished at, you know, the nigger this, nigger that, through the whole conversation. I had a high school classmate who was a member of the first exchange from Vassar to Dartmouth. Okay? And it wasn't a lot different for those women hearing when they came here. And you think institutional racism is perpetuated in southern colleges to this day?
Yes.
And you don't think women's issues were that important because you weren't inculcating that either. So think about that one.
Delighted that you brought up women. And I'll avoid any quips after that. But one of the things that we've been trying to do at the Dickey Center is actually do more and more programming on the growing area of policy towards women around the world. And the reason we've been doing that is that one of the sort of central discoveries of social science of the last 30 or 40 years is that there is absolutely nothing more important to the health of a developing society than the education of women and girls. And relatedly, we find that in societies in which women are more empowered, they can play a much more important role in conflict resolution, in countering extremism, in if they're in the workplace, it tends to have a lot more benefits for the economy. And out of you know, interest in this, and I confess it was not possible to work in Hillary Clinton's State Department and not be fascinated by the possibilities here, and we did have some really great programming in these areas. But we did a series of four visits and lectures last fall and this winter that looked at the question of women in policy and policy towards the world's women. We had the former president of Kosovo who was here, Michel Flournoy I mentioned, former Undersecretary of Defense, Milan Verveer, who was the first global envoy for women's issues in the State Department, and Isabel Coleman, who was one of our representatives, one of our ambassadors at the UN, who had written a path-breaking book on women in the Middle East and how they're negotiating really difficult social issues as they try to become more important in their own communities. And I think that this is a really important area of focus, and we found lots of undergrads who were really, really interested in delving into these issues. This is an area in which governments and international institutions like the World Bank are way out in front in terms of you know, exploring policy implications here. And it's not really taken root yet in the academy, but it's a place where we're hoping to make a mark over the long term.
Are you thinking only in terms of international, or should we look at this country too?
So our charter is international. Mm-hmm. And I'd be happy to give you the address of the Rockefeller Center across the street if you want to talk to them. But you know, I try.
Cross fertilize.
Not touching that word. Yes, I think it's really important. Period. But our mandate at Dickey is really international, so you'll give us a pass on that one.
No.
So we all carry around biases, and I think mine is focused based on 55 years of living in Silicon Valley. I'm not hearing much about technology, and my perspective is that technology is outstripping social institutions. I'd be interested in the panel, their perspective.
Good question.
Good question.
It's hard to make a brief comment on that.
Use the mic, though.
One of the things which has happened since we left Dartmouth, in fact it started in the decade after we left Dartmouth, is that income inequality in this country started to increase. In fact, my research indicates that we reached our highest level of equality about 1970, and from then on, we became less equal. Technological change has played a large part of this. International trade has played part of this. The development of a transfer society has also contributed to this by making it possible for people who are unemployed by technological change or international trade to stay in the regional areas where there are no longer opportunities for them. There is a theorem in economics, the Heckscher-Ohlin theorem, says that if you have international trade and you have technological trade, technological change, that the countries that have comparative advantage in technological industries will see an increase in the incomes of the people who are associated in that industry and decreases in the relative income of the other parts of the society, but it will help the rest of the world, their less skilled labor. I think one of the big questions that is facing our nation now, one of the great issues, is how we deal with the impact of technological change on the labor force. And I won't go on from there. I could go on at length like most professors, but you've raised a very important point.
I can just add, so you're undoubtedly correct, and I think that, you know, as we've gotten farther and farther into the post-election recap, there's more and more being published on the fact that automation has had a more decisive impact on the American workforce than trade has, and the prospects for the future are kind of gripping, if not horrifying. You know, if we just go along the trajectory we're on towards automated cars, you know, self-driving cars, we're talking, I believe, and you probably know the figures better than I do, about a job loss of something like 10 million, which would be staggering. Now, I say that recognizing that every time we face one of these crises of modernization, the Luddites were wrong. And our workforce and our economy has adapted. But this is obvious. There's no economic law that says that will always be true. And so it is certainly something worth looking into. I believe that this falls under my heading of polarization, because I think that the two are deeply intertwined. And I think that we'll be doing a lot more discussion on campus about exactly these issues, but I do not believe that we've even figured out yet how to approach these issues beyond talking to the scholars and bringing in some policymakers who are thinking about it.
Well, I have to say one quick thing about that. The economists I've read on this all point out to the problem with the disparity in income, which has increased enormously over the last 10, 15 years, is certainly related to technology, but the real key factor is education. And that's a terrible problem. And as Ambassador Benjamin points out, the possibility of self-driving automobiles, trucks, cars, and so forth, raises awful consequences. So much of that workforce to obtain those jobs, and how do you convert them into highly educated people to deal with high technology? To a certain extent, there's not an equal distribution of brain power, which I'm afraid this college is not capable of dealing with. Nobody's capable of dealing with that. But that's an underlying problem.
Well, one of the things that you didn't mention, which I think is quite essential to this discussion, is the Cuban Missile Crisis. And I think there's an analogy between the Cuban Missile Crisis and the Hungarian Revolution. Because in both of those instances, we had the nuclear thing in play. passive return, rollback is a great idea until you realize the other guy's got a lot of replay of weapons. And that was the same, and we talked about a lucky generation. We were lucky that we didn't get into a nuclear war and a few initial parts, and it was awfully darn close. And that's a problem that's going to be with us for forever unless we do something about this nuclear question.
May I add something on that? Because Ambassador Benjamin says, and he was, of course, a counterterrorism expert in the State Department, he says we've exaggerated at this point, in relative terms, the threat of terrorism. I spent a year and a half, almost 2 years, on a leave of absence as co-chairman of Bush's Intelligence Commission. And I have to tell you, almost every night I went to bed having nightmares thinking about someone getting into Washington or New York with a nuclear weapon in a briefcase. And the technology to do so is increasing rapidly. And so the moment that happens, your entire perception of threats in the world is going to change dramatically. And I'm sort of surprised that you say that this, Ambassador Benjamin, this is we exaggerate my concern about terrorism.
If I can address that. So you make an excellent point, and as the as, for example, Pakistan continues to manufacture tactical nuclear weapons, that is a huge concern. And it may be that to some extent, because of the experience we've had in counterterrorism with weapons of mass destruction and with the very limited ability of terrorist groups to manage programs to acquire them either through fabrication or theft. Sometimes I think of that problem as being a non-proliferation problem more than a terrorism problem. I guess what I am saying, and I'm in no way detracting from your point, and that's why I also said I think we need to continue spending a lot of money on counterterrorism. I think that we have sometimes underestimated our ability to continually innovate and improve our systems for border controls and for intelligence broadly, and which would also apply to the detection of weapons of mass destruction. I remember very well, and wrote a book, you know, that was all about the threat of WMD terrorism, especially when linked with religiously motivated terrorists. And so I consider that still to be, you know, the very top of the threat chart. My statement was, first of all, that we should not attend to terrorism and forget states, which I think is very important. And if you look at the last election, when something like 84% of the American public said that the economy was the top issue, and 80% said that terrorism was for them, you know, right at the top. You know, everyone was ranking their different threats, and you know, great powers, Russia, China, etc., were nowhere to be found. My only suggestion is that we need to be able to walk and chew gum at the same time, juggle and play the violin too. And so I don't mean to suggest that terrorism isn't an issue, and WMD terrorism remains the area of greatest concern for policymakers as it was throughout the Obama administration. I'm just saying, I think we've dropped a stitch or two here if we're not also looking at all the damage that can be done to us by other states, and I consider the violation of the integrity of our elections to be an attack on U.S. sovereignty on par with just about anything you can think of in the last century.
One of the key questions that is in my mind, and I'm sure it's in that of many, is whether Putin is simply an irritating mischief maker able to poke at us at small, vulnerable points, or if there is something more significant to what he is doing. I don't know the answer, but I think that's a question we have to continually keep in front of us.
Thank you. Charles Tsakalos. My experience as a senior
pretty profound when it came to great issues. And what I don't have a question as much as a comment or a question about what's going on in the college today. I know that the freshmen, the scholars, are freshmen, and I think they experience probably a longer period of time over 3 or 4 years. But I guess when we were freshmen, my suspicion is that we weren't as sophisticated as a lot of the current students. I believe that's true. That's my gut. So when I was a senior, it was an appropriate time for me to really have a course in great issues. Because it did a couple of things. One is I was a little bit more sophisticated, and it also made me a citizen of the world, I felt. I felt that all of a sudden this was a grown-up course. This was about life. Now my question is, if I were a non-Dickey scholar, if I was a kid from Tallahassee, and I was a student here, would I have had any great experience, formal training at Dartmouth College, or would I have to go through the Dickey scholarship program?
My question is, other than the scholars, the Dickey scholars, does a regular student have the experience of discussions of great issues?
I think the short answer is yes, because we have a constant, constant fuselage of programs going on all the time, open to all students. And one of the things about getting people to come to Dartmouth is they can't get here and leave here that fast, so we tend to program them a lot. And we get them into a lot of different classes.
Classes or programs?
And I know I've taken to calling it the Baton Death March, because they come up and then we send them to 5 classes. They meet with the kids who are running our publications. They do a number of different meetings with different groups. You can be a Dartmouth student and get from one end of freshman year to the end of your senior year without worrying too much about the world's problems. There's no compulsion in this. There's no class for all seniors, as there was a long time ago. But I think that we do draw from all over campus for different kinds of events, and I'd like to think that we're doing better with every passing year. I will say one observation I have, and I wasn't here in 1957, but compared with classes even a bit later, I think that the one thing that you might be shortchanging is the extent to which your class and many classes around it had shared historical consciousness in a way that students today do not necessarily, and I think that's one of the big challenges we face. I find this, I teach, and I find that the shared understanding of American history, of global history, the historians, the young history students have it, but because of changing patterns of media consumption, because people don't consume whole newspapers the way we all did before the advent of the internet, I think that there's a very different understanding. I think that's actually a real challenge for the country.
May I add to that? I've been teaching law at Harvard, NYU, and Georgetown for 32 years. And now I'm on a full-time faculty at Georgetown for those 15 years. My students, many of whom come from the Ivy League today, are less well-educated in history, government, English, humanities, than we were. Decidedly less.
Because
they are better than we were in economics, because of the Chicago School, I think. Economics and technology, because we weren't as familiar with technology. But the general education level is less. And that's partly the problem with elite schools not requiring core curriculums. You agree with me, Ambassador?
Yes. I have a follow-up, as I said, Washington.
I have a follow-up, sir. I guess my question is, when we were forced to take great issues, there's no choice.
And we bought, we said, the seniors and all that kind of thing, but we were forced to do it. And as a result, we learned one hell of a lot. So, Larry, your observation, I tend to agree with. And so, what does current education do about it?
Well,
for instance, I would think that, I would like to think that Dartmouth sometime in junior, senior year would have a course in international affairs, a required course on great issues. I am one of them. I might be in the end of fall.
What's a great idea, and I'm not the right address.
It's a well-led.
It's 3 o'clock, and I guess it's my job to say it's time to end. Oh, I'm sorry, there's one last, very last question. Go ahead.
Yeah, I would be interested in, I haven't heard much about the Middle East. I haven't heard much about an explosive situation in Israel-Palestine. My concern is that I just wonder where the role is in terms of examining this issue, because I see, frankly, I see it as the last, if not one of the last, if not the last, settler colonial situations in the world. Yeah. We have within Israeli society not only de facto discrimination, but discrimination by law, de jure, very similar to the Jim Crow situation we had here. We even have the construction of a wall, not on the international green line, but as part of a system of land confiscation. And I think we have a media, frankly, that it's not giving this balanced coverage. Certainly we hear one narrative and not another. And the government that supports it more than any other government in the world. I just wonder where in great issues where you place this issue.
There's enormous amount of interest on campus in these issues, and accordingly we do an awful lot of programming. One of the things that I probably didn't mention before is that my own one of my major initiatives is to try to bring more people from the policy world to Dartmouth for extended periods of time. And so last fall we had Rand Beers, class of 64, who when he left government, or shortly before he left government, was the acting Secretary of Homeland Security. He spent the fall term here, and he's taught a course. He'll be back next fall to teach a course again in the policy, on the policy process. This term, we had Ambassador Johnny Carson, nothing to do with late night TV, was probably the outstanding Africanist of his generation, had been Assistant Secretary of State for Africa the first Obama term, had been ambassador in Uganda, Kenya, and Zimbabwe, and he taught a seminar here. In February, we had for a month the number two figure from the Israeli Foreign Ministry, and the former Israeli ambassador to Germany, and he did quite a number of public events, including one we did with another visiting scholar here who was from the Egyptian Foreign Ministry. And it was terrific, and there's enormous student interest. I had 60 students show up for an impromptu discussion of prospects for peace just 2 weeks ago upstairs in Haldeman.
And Dan, wasn't that on YouTube?
No.
I think I saw that on YouTube.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
I'll have to look, see if there is any question. We had the foremost pollster from the Palestinian Authority, from the Palestinian territories here last year. We did a panel on the future of the U.S.-Israeli relationship that included former National Security Council senior director for the Middle East, as well as class of 50 or 51 member Al Moses, who had been in the Carter and the Clinton administration, had been the president of the American Jewish Committee. So we're doing quite a lot of programming on this issue. It's hardy perennial in terms of student interest. We try to get a variety of different voices, and there are a lot of other voices addressing it across the campus.
Okay.
I can just
say.
Okay.
I think the answer among us. Bill, you want to make a very brief comment or
yes,
a question?
A very brief comment, not a speech, and not a question. It seems to me in the discussion of the last half hour or so that Great Issues Course should be reinstated. Everybody agrees
Great Issues Course should be reinstated.
There is enough education in history, but
I agree with you.
Before you roll the part, Tom Macy has a presentation.
Dan?
Yeah.
Oh.
Are you
Tom?
Is this when I get paddled?
With a very soft paddle. It's been our pleasure, mine in particular, at homecomings the last several years, to present you with a check. You or one of your representatives, and last fall we gave Melody $20,000. We rounded off at the end of the year, so I have a check for you for $5,000 more for the Dickey Center Great Issues Fund, and actually an additional 200 for classmates who just contributed today. You stole my thunder a bit by announcing that we had $527,000. Actually, we have $531,683 plus 200 more in the Great Issues Fund. Now, if you remember in February 2013, we sat in the Class 57 Dickey Center Library and talked about whether we could get this fund off the ground. Well, I was brave enough to predict that by now, at our 60th reunion, we'd have $150,000. My prediction skills aren't very good, but I'm happy to say we are well over $530,000 and climbing.
We obviously could go on longer, but I see I'm getting also signals from people getting to leave. So thank you for coming. Hope to see you at the same time tomorrow for our art and study. It's going to be great.